Victoria Canada ngày 13 tháng 9 2017. Ngày 13 tháng 9.
Along the way, I'm going to be pointing out some of the highlights of Victoria, telling you some stories, some trivia and history about Victoria. The subjects are interesting. Some of them are true. Your job is to determine which are which. Anyway. Washington is just at the base of the mountains. Every day we have a car ferry, runs four times a day in the summertime between Port Angeles and Victoria's Inner Harbor. We will likely see it at some point on the tour. Now, being on the water like this, we are exposed to a lot of heavy weather and a lot of wind. If you look ahead of us, some of the trees you see there appear to be growing, leaning away from the water, and that's because of an almost prevailing wind that trains them to grow that way. Victoria is, of course, on an island. It's Vancouver Island. We're at the very southern tip. It also happens to be the capital of the province of British Columbia. That would be like your state capital if you happen to be from the United States. I think most, if not all of you, are. You like Central Florida or not. Near the end of the tour, we're going to be going past the legislative building, sometimes called the Parliament Building. Duck pond here on the right. On Sundays, the model boating club, the boat boating club, comes down here and they display their toys. They sail around there. And one guy's got a remote controlled alligator that chases the boats around, and the jaws snap open and closed all the time. Kind of fun to watch. Here's one tree that is literally grown right over the roadway. I have to kind of creep over the yellow line a little bit to avoid hitting it. See the damage to the tree there. It's been hit by quite a few buses. So we're just coming up to a landmark. It is a monument on the left-hand side of the road. It says Mile Zero, and it marks the western end of the Trans-Canada Highway. Now that starts at St. John's, Newfoundland, and ends here in Victoria. It's the longest highway in North America, just under 5,000 miles in length.
Wow.
We do count a couple of ferry trips as part of that highway, but then we do count the ferries as part of our highway system. This is Beacon Hill Park just ahead of us. I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a moment. But we're coming up to another little landmark. It's not marked or anything. It's a tree. Now, we have a lot of wildlife that is native here, including bald eagles. They've just come down from Alaska, so I'm sure you've seen some. These live right in the city. There's not a lot of them, but there are a few. Anyway, about 12 or 15 years ago, there was an article in the local newspaper. We had a violent winter storm here. As I told you before, nothing unusual about that. But this was different. It blew an eagle's nest down out of one of these trees.
Oh.
It's one of these tall trees that you see just ahead of us here, the tallest ones. It's actually a clump of several trees. Well, the next morning, some of the locals were pawing through that nest to see what they could find, and boy, did they get a surprise. In that nest, they discovered 11 catcallers. 11. Now, most cats don't wear collars, so you do the math. It's pretty easy to figure out what the favorite food of that eagle was. That story is absolutely true. There is no fake news in Canada. So we are entering Beacon Hill Park now, and this is about 160 acres. It was donated to the city of Victoria back in the 1860s. There were two conditions attached to the donation. One is that it had to remain parkland in perpetuity, and secondly, that no commercial activities should ever be allowed to take place within the park. The only thing that comes close to that is a petting zoo that's been here for decades that operates on donations only and therefore escapes the commercial clause. This is it coming up on the right. Now, we're likely to see some peacocks around. They're part of the petting zoo, but they come and go at will over the fence. There will likely be some in there, sitting up on fences and tables and things like that. But there's a pecan just to the right there. But it's a wonderful little petting zoo. They have all sorts of animals in there. People in Victoria, many of them have grown up attending that. Much love. Now, the park itself here has been developed to one degree or another about half. There's all sorts of things here. There's ponds that you see here, a rose garden, water features. There's a band shell where they have free performances. There's something for everything. Eyes open, you might see deer in the tall grass along here. This is my first day back in 8 weeks, so a lot of these animals are kind of territorial. They're in the same place, but in eight weeks I may have lost track of them a little bit. But most of the summer, the deer are around here. There we have a very large wild, not so wild, Victoria. They've all been born here, so they're pretty used to people. I wouldn't call them tame, but they don't get excited when people come close to them. They're quite used to them. Now, just to the left here, as we come out beyond the trees, is the world's tallest totem pole. It's 127 feet deep, carved out of one log.
Oh, wow.
It's been there since the mid-1950s, and it's been restored several times, but it's beginning to get a little bit tired.
Being out in the weather, it gets
absorbed a lot of water, and but that's part of the lore of the totem poles, as they are expected to rot and rejoin the earth. You get another view of that totem pole from a little distance away.
Là cao nhất trong thế giới, 150 feet.
Anyway, you might note that to the right here is an off-station dog park. People in Victoria bring their dogs down here, and it's amazing they have very few problems with the dogs. Some say it's because they're not protecting their territory. They come down here and they make nice with all the other dogs and have a great time. Now, again, going back to what I told you before about this prevailing wind that we get off the water, it comes in on the cliff, it's straight up, creates an upright. We have a community of hang gliders that operate off of this cliff. Now, the new modern hang gliders, they look like the parachutes, the oval puffs, I guess. They're not the wings like they used to be. But they'll jump over there, and they're very maneuverable. They'll go up, they can catch the updraft and ride back and forth along this cliff for hours. Now, they've discovered a great sideline to their sport. And with that maneuverability, they're able to dive bomb the dogs, and it drives them crazy. The dogs have a great time barking at these hang gliders, and the hang gliders are honing their skills, and the owners are sitting there just having a ball watching. Good time is ahead, my own. This is also the home right here. They have a lot of kite flying competitions, and it's a big thing. You know, it sounds like kind of a thing. It brings a lot of people to Victoria, and they have hundreds of participants in there. Keep your eyes open, and you may see seals out here in the water. Seals and otters.
Yeah, that what?
This is Ross Bay on the right. It was named after Isabella Ross. She was the first female landowner in British Columbia. She had another strike against her besides being female. She was half Native Indian. So it was quite remarkable. It was way back when. Now, on the left here, Boston Cemetery. This is the first large cemetery that was built for the people of Victoria. Prior to this, they just had small churchyards in the downtown area. We have a group of six or seven deer that live in this cemetery, and we see them about half of the time when we come by here. So keep your eyes open now, too. At any rate, when you walk to this cemetery, it's like walking through history. When you read the names on the tombstones and gravestones, you'll often know that they match names of neighborhoods, street names, landmarks, and even businesses that still exist in Victoria today. There's a deer on the left. See, it's not even looking up at the bus. It's right beside the road.
Yeah, it is.
That's what I mean. They're not tame, they're not afraid. They tend to live in the heaviest, most heavily settled parts of Victoria. They'll set up camp in someone's backyard and have three or four families and farms while living there. These are the people that won't shoo them away. We have kind of a love-hate relationship with them because everyone loves to see them, but boy, they can go through a garden in just an hour. Be a lot of problems. Great neighborhood that we're going through now. It got its start back in 1929. Of course, that was the beginning of the Great Depression. It was a gentleman who owned a lot of real estate here, and he very quickly realized that he was in trouble, and he put... Now one of the things you may be noticing is that all of the houses historically in Victoria, builders would buy one single lot and build the house on. Each house would be very different. It was only in the last maybe 15 years that they started building some of the tract homes you might be familiar with, but those are all in the outskirts of the suburbs. Now, you might find this a bit odd, but this is the poor part of Oak Bay. You gotta trust me on that. We are going to be going into the wealthy part soon. The Strait of Juan de Fuca over here is the main shipping channel between Seattle, Vancouver, and the open Pacific Ocean. I see one freighter out there right now. What we often see is some of the ships will come and anchor in a Esquimalt harbor over here, not too far from where your ships where your ship is. But the people here take a lot of pride in their yards and gardens. As I mentioned to some of you before, this has been a very unique year. We went 70-some days without rain. That's unheard of in Victoria. So it was really dry. You're going to see a lot of very dry lawns and whatnot. But you can also see some of the people with shrubbery and stuff like that. They have taken great care of it. People have a lot of pride in their area as well. Good examples coming up here on the right. See this birdhouse sitting about 15 feet to the sidewalk? It's not a birdhouse. That's a lending library. Take a book, leave a book. And we have those scattered all over Victoria. Here's a little story. A few years ago, I was doing a tour of an open-top double-decker bus coming the other direction. There's a gentleman out in his front yard mowing along. Just house coming up here on the left with the bridge and drive. There's no shrubbery there, so he was wide open for all to see. He was wearing nothing but his underwear. Now, I was humiliated. I'm pointing out the other way. See, that's Trial Island out there between us and that container ship. That's the last remaining man lighthouse on the west coast. At any rate, people had already seen this guy and they recognized a photo opportunity when I saw him. I could hear the cameras clicking and that is what they were going to remember Victoria by.
Oh wow.
So,
hear that one?
On a lighter note, this house on the right up here, the white one on the right, was up for sale. That was also about 4 years ago. The realtor had a sense of humor. She advertised it as having a low maintenance backyard. See that cluster of rocks out to the right there, a little bit in the distance? There's a couple of colorful Adirondack chairs and a picnic table up there. Interesting story. They've been there for about 4 years now. They've not been vandalized or stolen. They're much used. People go out there to sunbathe or even meditate or just get away from the husband and wife. But very popular, used a lot. Now one chair appeared, the other one didn't appear for about a year. The story behind the first chair was a gentleman that lived on the left-hand side of the road here. Had broken up with his girlfriend. He got a new girlfriend, as people tend to do. But she didn't like that chair that the other wife had. So one night after dark, I snapped the chair across and put it on the rocks, and it was an instant success. The people of Victoria loved it, and it has become a fixture. They have had a couple of pokes of this though. You get a lot of weather out there. Now, this is the Victoria Golf Club, and it is the oldest golf course, established golf course in Western Canada. It's not unusual to see a deer mingling with the golfers out here. Sizable. There had to have been something. There's a deer straight ahead of us, crossing the road. doesn't even look up at us. So, I know I talked to some of the early people on the bus, and they had been out to Butcher Gardens in the past. Most people come to Victoria have been there. You certainly saw the tour to the gardens advertised when you were looking at this tour. At any rate, the owners of Butcher Gardens used to own the house just on the right here, behind the stone wall. I'm going to go slowly by the driveway here. It has been sold. They used to have the gardeners come in and take care of their own gardening needs here. The new owners don't do quite as good a job, but you can still get a sense of what the gardens were like. They often had wedding receptions held outdoors there. It's a wonderful place. And you'll notice that on top of this stone wall, there is a wire fence, and that's there designed to keep the many deer out that live in this area. And you know I'm not lying, because you've seen a couple of deer already. Now, if you look out to the left, there's a scraggly tree, and there are three eagle's nests in one at the very top. One down quite a bit, or a little bit to the right, and then another one straight below that.
Yeah.
But
you can see if one of those nests fell out of the tree, you'd want to check in there and see what. Now, I think two of those nests are no longer used, but earlier this year I saw two eagles perched in the top nest. Mm. So if you're getting a taste for Victoria right now and you think you might want to have a summer home here, you might want to rent an apartment in this building on the left. Sign for it, the White House. Imagine telling your friends that you lived in the White House. Mm. Wouldn't they be impressed? He submitted the plans, and lo and behold, he beat out 62 qualified architects in order to win the commission to build the buildings. Quite remarkable, seeing that he was only 25 years old.
Wow.
He had no formal training in architecture, and he'd never, ever built anything before in his life. He lied about his credentials in order to over with. The job was a pretty brave move on his part. Anyway, he became eventually a very good architect and became very wealthy. He built this mansion just to the right here. Now, by today's standards, it's not huge, but it was beautiful and large. But today, it's an exclusive elementary school, private elementary school. You can see where they've added on to it. I'll tell you a little bit more about this as well. He had a talent for surrounding himself with people who knew what they were doing. He would hire them to do the work that he was incapable of doing. And then he would claim the credit for it. It caused a lot of hard feelings. Throughout his career and his life, he was in constant conflict. He was in court a lot, made lots of enemies. But he was also, you know, quite famous. People wanted to rub shoulders with him. He became head of high society in Victoria. It was a very small, select group of people. But that was his mission in life, was to be part of high society. We've got a beautiful floral display coming up here on the left-hand side of the road. This guy, he goes through 3 or 4 plantings a year. You know, as they begin to fade, he'll pull everything out and change it to something else. It's just beautiful. And of course, it's behind the deer fence. He couldn't do that otherwise. The deer roam freely in amongst all of these homes. They're quite comfortable here. So anyway, Francis Rattenbury designed the legislative building. Using other people's labor caused a lot of hard feelings. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that when we get downtown. But we've seen the Parliament buildings when we get down there. Now we're coming up to one of the very early planned communities. It's called the Uplands. It's also part of Oak Bay, and it is the wealthy part of Oak Bay. We'll gradually work into it, but we entered as we come through these stone pillars. One of the first things you'll notice that there are no overhead wires. Even back then, this was about 1905 or so when they started this subdivision. Here's one of our modern cars. It was a modern subdivision back in 1905, but even then they put the wiring underground. Had a lot of regulations here. Hedges couldn't be over 6 feet tall. Well, that has changed, obviously. A lot of the people up here, there are some true mansions up here for privacy's sake. They've grown the hedges much taller. Oh! As I say, this is my first day back, but they may be filming a movie down here. Let's go check it out. We're going to be going down to Cattle Point here. Okay, it's a group park. We have a very active film industry in Victoria. This is Cattle Point. Prior to this being a subdivision, it was about 600 acres of farmland, a cattle ranch. And what they did, they would bring cattle in from the mainland on ships. Now, they were intended to bring them down to Victoria's Inner Harbor. They'd have to go down where your ship is, around that ship, and into the Inner Harbor. And it was expensive. It took a lot more time. And when they used the government wharf down there, they had to pay a tariff. So what they ended up doing is they would bring the ships in as close to shore as they dared here, and they'd push the cattle overboard, and the cattle would swim to shore. It didn't get any better than that. And that's why it's called Cattle Point. And yes, they are actually filming down here. When we get downtown, I'll point out a few film locations. Just to the right there, see that white car box? That is a public piano. Anyone can come down here and play that piano. And they've got several of them scattered around Victoria. They all have covers like this that people put on at night, or if it starts to rain. As you can imagine, the film industry industry brings a lot of revenue into the area. Very good for the local economy. Yeah, this would be the crew park on the left, but they are actually filming on the right there. Straight ahead of us is the First World War Monument. It's a memorial to the fallen soldiers, and it's dedicated to mothers and sons. Now we are entering the Uplands proper. All the houses on the right are going to be waterfront property. Most of them are going to be... There's a deer on the left.
Good night.
Most of them are fairly well hit by shrubbery and whatnot.
Wow. Yeah, that way.
The signs that you see up here are not placed by the city. The ones that say caution, expect deer. Those are put up by concerned citizens. They do get hit by cars fairly often. Side, after we cross the street, there's about four true mansions in a row, and none of them you get to see very well. One of them is a grand old stone mansion. It was occupied by an evangelist preacher by the name of Brian Rudd. He was there for about 3 years before moving on to his next residence, which was a federal penitentiary in the United States. I'm sure you've heard variations of that story. Up here, the money comes from many sources. A lot of it is old money, a lot of business money. Now, the business center of Canada has traditionally been Toronto, but it's gradually been moving west to Vancouver. A lot of these people, when they retire, they come here because the climate here is the best in Canada. I'll explain a little bit more about that later. There are some business people coming here. There's a lot of Asia money. A few celebrities live here, or at least part-time. And there are a few houses that are occupied by people, but we just don't know where the money comes from. Source is suspect.
Wow.
Now, earlier in the year, I was coming by here. Oh, and there's another piano straight ahead of us. It's looking out over Royal Victoria Yacht Club. Prince Philip is a member of that yacht club. He's only 6 years old. They keep his name on the roster for bragging rights. Goldie Hawn and Kurt Russell own a home just back on the right on that point. They're part-time. We're coming up to a house on the right. This spring I was doing a tour from here. It was garbage day. Garbage bins out on the street. I'd already told the people who lived in this house coming up here, this is one of the many houses owned by Tom Selleck. I had a lady wanted to stop and go through his garbage. Think of the souvenirs you can find. It's this house just to the right here. So we're going to be leaving the uplands as we pass through these stone pillars, and we'll be entering into the municipality. Isenhower in the region. It is not a poor area by any means.